Good evening.
Good evening, Mark.
Love you too. We are going through Passion Week this week. This is the most important week in history, you know that? It's right up there with December that we remember the birth of Christ. But this week is so important because Christ has fulfilled about every prophecy there was. He's rode into Jerusalem on a donkey, just like Zechariah 9 says, and just like Daniel chapter 9 was prophesying. He rode in to the day with people shouting Hosanna. And this week I've just been reading over the Gospels and looking at the last days of Jesus. And really, when we get to this place in the Bible, we are at about the last day of Jesus' life. And you know what blows my mind? He's serving everybody else. He's concerned about everybody else. He's not crying about himself. He's concerned about everyone else. So we're going to be in John chapter 12 if you want to start heading in that direction. I went last night and saw the movie, The Case for Christ. Oh, man. You know, a lot of times they say the book is always better, right? In this case, I think the movie might be better than the book. I got the book right here. So, the reason I brought it is I'm giving it to somebody. So, but I don't want to spoil it, but let me tell you something. From the beginning of the movie, it pretty much captures you, and it's just an amazing movie. What God does in this family and how he goes about doing it is truly amazing. And what happens when this man, Lee Strobel, who was a journalist for the Chicago Tribune, what God does with this man is just amazing. He's a proud dude, really intelligent guy, and he could not accept God. He could not believe there was such a thing as God. So he investigates, man. This guy did some investigating. He went to all the scholars, asking all the big questions. I'm not going to spoil the movie, but I got to tell you this one part. Towards the end, he goes to California. He flies from Chicago to California because he wants to see a doctor that knows about everything about the crucifixion of Christ. I'm not going to spoil it, but I'll tell you this. The doctor's done explaining to him about the crucifixion and how he knows Christ died, Lee Strobel says, "That's not what I wanted to hear." And let me tell you something. He wasn't wanting to hear the truth. And through the whole movie, he prided himself on finding the truth in every story. But when it came to Jesus, he was ignoring the truth. I'll tell you what, that's a good one. So anyway, let's pray and we'll get in. I call this the last days of our Lord. And I put he was about his father's business right up to the very end. Right up to the very end. So, let's pray. Father, we love you and we praise you. Just want to give this time to you. And Lord, I just pray that as we just kind of take a journey through this last day of Jesus here on earth, that God, you touch our hearts and let us realize we're not reading a fairy tale. This is not like the Easter Bunny or Santa Claus. This is real. This really happened 2,000 years ago, that the Son of God came down from heaven, and this last day on earth is recorded right here for us to read. And so, Lord, I just pray that we'd be able to learn from this awesome book here. In Jesus' name, amen. So, immediately after, he came in to Jerusalem on the donkey, and you can read in Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 through 3, immediately after he went and cleansed the temple. And then we come to John chapter 20, or chapter 12, verse 20. And Jesus speaks of his death. So verse 20, now there were certain Greeks among those who came up to worship at the feast. These were Gentiles. So these are, Jesus had reached out to the Jewish people, and these are Gentiles now wanting to talk to Jesus. And they came to Philip, and who was from Bethsaida and Galilee, and asked him, saying, sir, we wish to see Jesus. Philip came to and told Andrew, and in turn, Andrew and Philip told Jesus. I don't know why they worked it out that way, but that's how they worked it out. And this is what Jesus tells them. He just cuts right to the chase. This is the end of his life. This is it. It's over. Jesus answered them and said, the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. He's talking about being glorified, and he's talking about going to the cross, being glorified. That after that, what's going to happen? He's going to be raised in his resurrected body. And verse 24, I love this verse. It just says, most assuredly, or verily, verily, or truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain. So Jesus, right after he rides into Jerusalem, and they're gathered now, and they're about to have the Last Supper. That's what we're going to look at more in detail. But what does he tell them? He tells them, if a grain of wheat dies, it's going to bear a lot of fruit. Do you realize that says to all of us that we must die to bear fruit? I'll tell you what, if you ever really want to bear fruit, it's going to be a battle. I'm telling you right now, it's a battle, I'm being. Pastor Pete can tell you, any pastor in this room can tell you it's going to be a battle. And Jesus says, unless I die, I'm not going to be able to bear fruit. But because he has died, I mean billions of people have come to Christ and got saved. And now they're in heaven because of the death and resurrection of Jesus. So he talks about his death. And then in verse 37, or verse 28 through 30, the Father speaks. And it says, Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven saying, I have both glorified it and will glorify it again. Therefore the people who stood by and heard it said, it thundered. Others said, an angel spoke to him. Jesus answered and said, this voice did not come because of me, but for your sake. So we have Jesus saying what's going to happen. Then we have the Father speaking from heaven saying, I have glorified your name. So we got the Father and the Son right here after the triumphant entry. I believe it's triumphant because he entered in after never sinning. And then we have the scripture itself speaking about this time. In verses 37 through 41 it says, but although he had done so many signs before them, they did not believe in him, that the word of Isaiah the prophet might be fulfilled which he spoke. Lord, who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? Therefore, they could not believe, because Isaiah said again, he has blinded their eyes and hardened their hearts, lest they should see with their eyes, lest they should understand where their hearts had turned, so that I should heal them. So now you have the Father speak, you have Jesus saying, I've come to die, and then you have the scriptures saying, this is all the fulfillment of Isaiah, what we're looking at all around us. And then Jesus ends it like this, before we go to the Last Supper. And I love this. In verse 47, 48, he said, and if anyone hears my words and does not believe, I do not judge him. For I did not come to judge the world, but to save the world. He who rejects me and does not receive my words as that which judges him. The word that I have spoken will judge him in the last day. So Jesus says, after all this, my life that I've went through, after all the persecution, after all the lies that have been told about me, after all the rejection, and now I've grown into Jerusalem, and even though I'm the Lord from heaven, I didn't come to judge you. Do you realize that if he had come to judge, none of us would have made it?
Amen.
Not one person would have made it out alive. He said, I didn't come to judge. Why did he come? He came to save. He came to save you and he came to save me, Furman Cal. We had ruined it, man. It wouldn't matter if Adam and Eve had been perfect. The next one along would have sinned. But they didn't make it. God sent the best to represent mankind, Adam and Eve, and they failed. And from that point on, everybody has sinned. And so, now we go into the Last Supper. And I want to just look at the Last Supper for a little bit and talk about after the Last Supper, what's going to happen in the evening, that Jesus is going to go over the Brook of Kidron, and he's going to go out the East Gate. And that East Gate is going to shut. It was shut 1,500 years after Jesus walked through it by the Muslims. They said, Jesus ain't coming back through this gate. Oh, yes, he is. He's coming back through that gate. He said he was, and he's going to. But in chapter 13, in verse 1, it says, now before the feast of the Passover, so here we are now, they're sitting down for dinner. And when Jesus knew that his hour had come, that he should depart from this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. You know, the word actually means that he loved them to the uttermost. Right there, Jesus, when he said that, it says he loved them to the end, it's saying he couldn't have loved them any more than what he did. Do you realize he can't love you any more than what he does right now?
Amen.
For God so loved the world, he doesn't love you any more than he does me. And when we see people that we go, yuck, and we go, oh, I can't believe that, he loves them just as much as he loves you. When you see that prostitute or that cross-dresser, he loves them just as much. And so we get a picture of Jesus right there, that he loved them so much. And then we get a picture of the supper that Jesus is at with these 12 disciples. These guys are characters. These guys are something else. I think when we get to heaven and see these guys, they're just like us. They failed so miserably. They thought all the wrong things. And we're going to see that at this Last Supper. And Jesus is going to teach them such a great lesson. In verse 2 says that supper being ended, a lot of pastors or commentators say that really it's like a part of what is ended. It's not completely ended. We'll see that. The devil already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going to God, rose from supper and laid aside his garments and took a towel and girded himself. So here you have the picture. We got these guys come in. They're sitting down for dinner. They probably eat the first course, and Jesus gets up from the table. Now when it talks about a towel, it's actually in the Greek, it's a linen cloth, and linen represents righteousness in the Bible. So when he grabs this cloth, that is righteousness that he's about to rub on these 12 guys. And he says, after that, verse 5, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and wipe them with the towel which he was girded. So the picture is not just that he's washing some people's feet. There's a spiritual picture here that's going on. And Jesus is looking at guys sitting around eating. And we're going to see what they're talking about in just a few minutes. But he begins to show them something in servanthood. And he begins to pour water into a basin. And water in the Bible is a picture of being cleansed by God. In fact, let me read you out of Titus chapter 3, verse 5. It says this, Titus 3, 5. Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us, through the washing of the regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. So the washing of the regeneration, talking about the Holy Spirit washing us. What is Jesus doing? He's wanting to wash these guys. But we're going to see it's not for salvation, because these guys are already saved. And in Ephesians 5:26, it says that
that he might sanctify, talking about the church, and cleanse her with the washing of the water by the word. So Jesus now, he's grabbed a towel which is representative of righteousness, and he's grabbing this water and he's washing their feet, which is a picture of the Holy Spirit washing. And he's doing this to these guys. And he comes to Peter, he washes all their feet. Now these guys, probably their feet probably stunk. You know, I thought about this. I thought about, why didn't somebody wash their feet? There was supposed to be somebody, when you come into somebody's house to have dinner, there was somebody appointed that was supposed to wash the feet. Somebody wasn't doing their job. Then Jesus decides, you know what, I'm going to take care of it for you guys. And what's going to be, we're going to see that's really funny that he takes care of it, because they're thinking other things. So verse 6, they came to Peter, and Peter said to him, Lord, are you washing my feet? Do you think Peter's kind of like going, what are you doing? And I think Peter probably might have thought, you know, I think he's testing us to see if we'll stop him from doing this. And we'll do it. Who knows, but Peter was about to say no. Jesus answered in verse 7 and said to him, what I am doing you do not understand now, but you will after this. And he will. Verse 8, Peter said to him, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered him, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. Now let me tell you, that speaks to us. Because remember what we got a picture of here is a picture of salvation, the washing of the water by the word. If you don't wash me, he said, if I don't wash you, you have no part with me. That's the same with all of us. Listen, if you're not washed by the water of the word, if you're not filled with the Holy Spirit, you have no part with Jesus. And so Peter says in verse 9, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. You know, it's funny because Peter reminds me of myself, how much I tell God what to do. Have you ever told God what to do? Have you ever been like this? You're talking to God, you're telling him all these things he needs to do, and then you realize that you're talking to him? And I've done this so many times, I go, you know what, I'm sorry, Lord, I know, you know what, you know what's best. I just give it to you. Because so often we're like, we're bossing God around. And that's what Peter tells him, first, don't wash my feet. Then he goes, oh, no, not my feet. Oh, wait, well, God said he's going to wash your feet. But Peter goes, not my feet, my head, my hands. I'm surprised Jesus didn't say, Peter, be quiet. And remember that old cartoon, I'll do the thing around here. Who was that? Who? Yeah, I'll do the thing around here thinking, said then. But he didn't do that. And the Lord just lets him know. You know what he says in verse 10? He who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean, and you are clean. But not all of you, he's speaking of Judas. Not all of you are clean. He said, listen, I don't need to wash your hands and your head. All I need to do is wash your feet. You are already saved. You're already one of mine, Peter. Peter misses the point. Just like so many times I miss the point that I am already saved. And I try to do extra things, thinking that somehow that's going to put extra brownie points. You know, whenever I get into this relationship with God, I just go, I'm so blessed to be saved. I'm so glad, God, that I'm just walking with you. And I just have a relationship with me and with my Creator. And I go, Lord, whatever you want to do, I'm here at your disposal. I'm ready. Like Isaiah said, here I am, send me, I'm willing. And when we get into that kind of an idea of a relationship with God, you know what happens? A peace of God that surpasses all understanding comes along our life, and pretty soon these little trivial things don't mean all that much anymore. You know, the things that wipe us out. And right here we're going to see the disciples. They're going to go from being big-headed to being shrunk down pretty quick. And so, it says in verse 12, so when he had washed their feet, taken his garments, and sat down again, he said to them, now this is good, he says, do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you say, well, so I am. If I am your Lord and teacher and have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I've given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Then he says, most assuredly I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than he who sent him. What do you think these guys were talking about when Jesus got up to wash their feet? Do you think they were talking about what a great entrance that was? Man, did you see our Lord coming in and all the palm branches laid down? Man, what a great God we serve. Read Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22 and verse 24. This is the same picture, the same table, the same time. Luke gives a different account. And this is what these godly men filled with the Holy Spirit talking about. Now there was also a dispute among them as to which one of them should be considered the greatest. So they're all sitting around talking about the Muhammad Ali syndrome. I'm the prettiest, I'm the greatest. Who's the greatest? Who's going to be the best? Here Jesus has just grown in, he's just told him he's going to die. And all they're thinking about is who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom. They're all concerned about that. I think that's the biggest problem in the church today. We need more feet washers. People that are willing to come in and clean and be able to do the menial tasks. And it's not a menial task to God. It's something that God loves when we put our hand to the plow. When Jesus decided to just wash their feet, he was saying that you need to be clean, but you don't need to be saved. Charles Spurgeon wrote about this. He said, the priest of God, when consecrated, first was washed from head to foot, and so baptized into the service of the sanctuary. But each time he went to offer sacrifice, he washed his feet and hands in the brazen laver. Brazen laver. So, what is he saying? When a priest first came in to serve, he would be washed from his head to his foot. That's us, you guys. When I first came in to serve God, I was washed clean by the power of the Holy Spirit. Head to foot, I was clean. I remember when I first got saved, I remember asking the guy, you mean he forgave me of everything? Because it blew my mind that I was forgiven of every evil thing I ever did. And the guy, I remember the brother going, you're forgiven of everything you've ever done. When God forgave you, you're forgiven of everything. But then what happens? I start walking with him and I start getting mud on him. You guys get a little mud on me this week? I got some mud on me today. And guess what I do? I go to the Lord and I ask for forgiveness. I got a bad temper. I still have a bad temper. I still want to hit people. I haven't hit somebody in a long time. Because of the Lord Jesus Christ. The love of God restrains me. But you know what? If you wanted to kill somebody, then aren't you done? Today I was wanting to kill people in my heart. And at the end of the day, I just went, and then you know, you get up and go, man, oh, this is such a great week. This is so awesome. Passion week. And then I find myself just all tore up inside. But you know what? I ask God to forgive me. He cleansed my feet. And now I can start walking again and get up because 1 John 1:9 says that we confess our sin. He's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Isn't that good news? Man, that's good news. That's great news. I need forgiveness all the time. I am nothing.
So, Jesus gives a great example for each and every one of us at this supper. That instead of saying, get the servant in here, wash these guys' feet, he says, watch this, fellas. As they're arguing about who's going to be the greatest, he says, watch this. And he goes down and begins to wash everybody's feet. He said, I did this for your example. You did this for my example, for your example. Next time somebody asks you to do something, I've had people ask me to do things this week and my pride swells up. And I gotta stop. I gotta quit acting like I'm better than others. I should be a servant. People are attracted to humility and to servanthood. One of the things that attracted me to God was some of the servants in the church. When I would see how they reacted and how they were willing to serve and set up and do things. And they didn't ask nothing in return. And that's what our Lord was doing for these guys. He didn't have to do this. But at this Last Supper, he showed us a great example, didn't he? But I want you to think about something at this Last Supper. In verses 18 through 38, there's an enemy among them. And his name is Judas. Right in the middle of all this serving, and do you think Jesus washed Judas's feet too? I know he did. He washed the feet of Judas. And look at verse 18. He says, I do not speak concerning all of you. I know whom I have chosen. But that the scripture may be fulfilled, he who eats bread with me has lifted up his heel against me. He was quoting Psalms 41, verse 9, which says, even my own familiar friend in whom I trusted, who ate my bread, has lifted up his heel against me. David wrote that about Ahithophel. Try to say that. Ahithophel. That was his name. You read about it in 2 Samuel chapter 17, verse 23. You know what happened to Ahithophel? In 2 Samuel chapter 17, and verse 23, he did just exactly what Judas did. He betrayed David, and he went out and hung himself. It was a perfect picture of what the future, what was going to happen. But Jesus says right here in this verse, he said, he who eats bread with me has lifted his heel against me. But then he kind of softens it a little bit. Remember, these guys are all about who's going to be the greatest up to this point. And then all of a sudden they got hit with, one of you guys are going to betray me. So man, Jesus has just washed their feet. And the ego is being deflated a little bit there. And then all of a sudden he tells them, now, one of you guys is going to betray me. Can you imagine the ego getting a little bit smaller at this point? Jesus is working on these guys. He's letting these disciples know, you cannot serve me and be concerned about being the greatest. You cannot serve me with a proud heart. You cannot serve me with the I need mine syndrome. You need to humble yourself. And that's what Jesus is doing at this Last Supper. He's saying, look at what I'm doing for you guys. And they watched him raise the dead. They watched him heal the lepers, cause the blind to see. They see him walk on water. Peter walked on water with him. And now here he is, washing their feet. And now he not only washes their feet, but now he's telling them, one of you are going to betray me. And he says, verse 19, now I tell you before it comes, that when it does come to pass, you may believe that I am. But then he softens it for him. He says, most assuredly, or truly, truly, I say to you, he who receives whomever I send receives me, and he who receives me receives him who sent me. So he kindly tells them, listen, you guys, you're saved. But can you imagine that if you're sitting at that table, what you would be thinking? When he says, the one who I eat bread with is going to, And then it says in verse 21, when Jesus had said these things, he was troubled in the spirit and testified and said, most surely I say to you, one of you will betray me. He just lays it out on the table. But look at what Jesus, right here it says, he was troubled in spirit. In verse 22, then the disciples looked at one another perplexed from what he said. So we got, now all of a sudden it went from, we're going to be the greatest, we're going to be the greatest, to now he's serving everybody, and now they're going, is it me? Can you imagine? It would be like you could hear a pin drop in the room. All of a sudden Jesus is bringing this whole thing home. Cut it out, guys. You're not all that in a bag of chips. You need to quit thinking so highly of yourselves. I think of Jesus when he says in Philippians 2, he humbled himself, took on the form of a servant. So in Matthew 26 and verse 22, at the same scene, Matthew brings out that they all began to say, is it I? Is it I? Is it me? If you were at that table, would you have been going, is it me? Is it me? I think any one of us, if we were at that table, would have been going, is it me? And you think about Peter. After all this happened and they had taken the Lord, remember, he was sitting by the fire and he denied the Lord. After the cock crowed three times, he denied him, and then he cursed and said, I don't even know him. Are we able to do that? I think it's now that we are filled with the Holy Spirit, I don't think we can do that anymore. I don't know, man. I mean, I wouldn't want to be put to the test, but I hope that I would pass that kind of a test. Like I read in the Fox's Book of Martyrs, how those guys would praise God while they're burning. Praise God in the face of death. John Fox, at that time, went around recording all the deaths of the saints. He wasn't even a Christian, but he recorded everything that happened, watched it happen. He watched as the pastor of the church of Smyrna was 84 years old. And they put him to the stake. And they said, all you have to do is deny Christ and you can live. And this old man looked at him and said, he has never done me any harm, but I'm not denying him. And they laid him on fire and he died. And so many of those people died praising Jesus, filled with the Holy Spirit of God. When the Holy Spirit came upon Peter, let me tell you something, that man was changed. He went in front of those guys and he wasn't scared to death no more. In fact, he said, crucify me upside down. He wasn't scared no more. I don't believe we could do that anymore. But this was before the pouring of the Holy Spirit came upon the saints. And look at these guys. I feel sorry for them because they're all sitting around the table. Is it me? Is it me? And verse 21, when Jesus has said these things, he was troubled in spirit and testified and said, most assuredly, I say to you, one of you will betray me. And the disciples looked at one another, perplexed about what he said. Now there was leaning on the bosom of one of his disciples who loved Jesus. Now we know it's John, right? Then leaning back on Jesus' breast, he said to him, Lord, we'll look for verse 24. Simon Peter therefore motioned to him to ask who it was of whom he spoke. So can you imagine Peter? He's probably going, find out who it is. Wouldn't you be like that? Lean over and whisper, try to remember who it is. You know. And I can't help but Peter was thinking, it could be me. Just like the rest of them, Matthew 26. Is it me? Is it me? Because we all doubt ourselves. Nobody's perfect. But and this is really cool, verse 25. Then leaning back on Jesus' breast, he said to him, Lord, who is it? You know, this tells me something right here. He was right next to the heart of God. Right next to the heart of God where John always wanted to be, John the Beloved. And guess what? He found out first. You want to find things out, spiritual things, deep things of God? Get next to the heart of God. How do you get next to the heart of God? Pray and read his word. Amen. Humble yourself, pray and read his word. And guess what? God's going to start revealing deep things to you. I'll tell you, there's nothing better in the world than to have God speak to your heart on deep things of the Holy Spirit. It's beautiful. And so Jesus answered, verse 26, "It is he to whom I shall give a piece of bread when I have dipped it." And having dipped the bread, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. Now after the piece of bread, Satan entered him. Then Jesus said to him, "What you do, do quickly." Now if you're studying what was going on here, whenever the master of ceremonies dipped the bread and they gave it to the person, that person at the table was the guest of honor. So he made Judas, Jesus Christ, made Judas Iscariot the guest of honor at the table that evening. And he still went out and sold him for 30 pieces of silver. What a cold, cold dude. You have to, like one pastor said, you have to fight with God to get into hell. And that's exactly what Judas did. He fought with God all the way to get into the gates of hell. And so, he goes out into the night. And then we see that the disciples are probably still wondering what's going on. We're almost done here. It says, verse 28, "But no one at the table knew for what reason he said this to him. For some thought because Judas had the money box that Jesus had said to him, 'Buy those things we need for the feast,' or that he should give something to the poor. Having received a piece of bread, he then went out immediately, and it was night. So when he had gone out, Jesus said, 'Now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify him in himself and glorify him immediately. Little children, I shall be with you a little while longer. You will seek me, and as I said to the Jews, where I am going, you cannot come. So now I say to you, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all will know that you are my disciples if you have love one for another." The last thing that he shares with them at this table, at this feast, is the greatest thing you guys can ever do is love each other. Isn't that a great thing to leave with? To let the disciples know it's not about how great you are. It's not about how much money you got. It's not about how tough you are. It's not about how smart you are. It's about how much love you have. If you have love, love covers a multitude of sin. Without love, we can't do nothing. We can't do nothing. If we're not doing, the Bible says in 1 John 4, God is love. And when the love, the first fruit of the Holy Spirit is what? Love. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, long-suffering, kindness, patience. But if you're going to ever have kindness and patience and all the rest, you've got to have love first. You've got to be filled up with the love of God. You know the hardest thing about love? It's loving your enemies. The hardest thing about love is to love your enemy. There's a scripture in Mark chapter 10, verse 27. I shared this with a young brother that's struggling with stuff a couple days ago. He said he can't quit doing stuff that he doesn't want to do. And I said, "You need to read Mark 10, 27, for with man it is impossible." Listen, with man it is impossible. With man it is impossible. You guys get that? You ever feel that way? But with God, all things are possible.
Amen.
Is that right?
Right.
So when God says, love your enemies, is it possible?
Yes.
Yes, it's possible. Are you going to? I was sharing with Sister Rick. I said, loving your enemies is getting harder and harder. Even as ISIS is doing the stuff they're doing to our brothers and sisters over there. I love what she told me. She said, if we love them, they might get saved and stop doing it.
Amen.
Isn't that true?
Amen.
If we just love those that love us, what good is that? Don't the heathens do that? Heathens do that. Jesus ended with this. Love is the greatest commandment, to love God and love your neighbor, right? From here, Jesus goes out, crosses the Brook Kidron, where the blood is flowing, goes up to the Mount of Olives on the east, and he will go up there, and he will say this to the disciples, pray with me. Know what they did? Remember that he goes over and kicks Peter in the side? Couldn't you pray with me 1 hour? Peter goes, oh, gosh, what? I think that's the reason when Peter woke up, he went and whacked that guy's ear off. Because he was half asleep. I don't think he would have done that if he was by the way. But this all happens the night before Christ goes to the cross. What did Jesus do when Peter whacked that guy's ear? He goes and he goes to that ground. Right to the very end, loving your enemies. Right to the very end, the guy that he healed might have been one of the guys that gambled at the cross. Might have been one of the guys that was making fun of him while he was hanging on that cross. But Jesus went and he healed because he loves everybody. Now I'll tell you what, we need to be that way, you guys. We need to be that way in these last days. This is such an awesome way, guys. Stopped at the gas station on the way here, and I just went in to get gas because, you know, the pump wasn't working. The lights went out, electric bill went out yesterday in Paris, and I guess the pumps didn't work. But I looked at that as that God wanted me to go talk to this girl inside. So I went in and I always say, hey, do you go to church? And this is what she tells me. I need to go to church. That's funny. I need to go to church. So I told her about our church. I said, well, come over to our church. But isn't that how God works? I got to tell you one more thing about this movie. And this is awesome. This is awesome. This is the last thing, okay? This is how God works. This is a true story. The beginning of the movie, and I will tell you about those. There's a bunch of great parts. This is just a couple.
Hi.
They go out to eat. The little girl goes over to the gum machine. She gets some gum. She comes back and she's choking. And she's ready to go out. And a lady comes over and she grabs her and she starts hitting her on the back. And it takes a while. They think the little girl has died and she starts breathing. This is how God works. The lady, the little guy, this least girl woman, he's an atheist. And, oh, thank you so much. Oh, I can't believe, thank you. Thank you. And she said, praise Jesus. Amen. She, you know what she tells them? This is the only thing, the only thing I can tell you. She goes, I was going to another restaurant tonight and God told me to come to this one. Through that many struggles, why got saved. I'm telling you, we serve an awesome God. I will say no more. We serve an awesome God, but we got to be there available to watch him work. I could have just went to another gas station where it's more available. But when you're going to find people that are going, I need to go to church. All I can do is go, do you go to church? I need to go to church. All we got to do is talk to people. Seems like we're so scared to talk to people today. God wants us to talk to people. Let me tell you something. He came to this earth 2,000 years ago. The last week he spent on this earth, he talked to everybody. He reached out to everybody. He cried out to everybody. He did everything he could, and the last thing on that cross, what did he say? As they were crucifying him, he looked out and he said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they did. He reached out to the very end. Amen?
Amen.
And that's the way we need to be. So you guys, invite somebody to the sunrise service for this Sunday. We're having it. Go tell everybody, come to church this Sunday, because Jesus rose from the dead. Amen? Jesus' name. And the church said,
amen. Amen.